बिस्मिल्लाहिर्रहमानिर्रहीम। अस्सलाम वालेकुम। सो होप यू आर फाइन। लेट्स स्टार्ट विद दिस टॉपिक ऑफ मेम्ब्रेन सेपरेशन। एंड एक्चुअली वी हैव टू डिस्कस टुडे गैस परमिएशन थ्रू द मेम्ब्रेन। सो क्विकली टू रिकॉल फ्रॉम लास्ट वीक, एक्चुअली लास्ट वीक वी स्टार्टेड विद द इंडस्ट्रियल एप्लीकेशंस ऑफ मेम्ब्रेन। एंड आई टोल्ड यू दैट इन योर कोर्स यू हैव टू स्टडी थ्री मेजर इंडस्ट्रियल एप्लीकेशंस आर यूज़ ऑफ मेम्ब्रेन। फर्स्ट वन वॉज फॉर रिवर्स ऑस्मोसिस, RO मेम्ब्रेन। देन देयर इज़ गैस परमिएशन, एंड द लास्ट एंड थर्ड वन इज़ अबाउट पारवेपोरेशन। सो दिस इज़ द सेकेंड एप्लीकेशन विच वी हैव टू डिस्कस। लास्ट वीक वी डिस्कस इन डिटेल रिवर्स ऑस्मोसिस इन टू लेक्चर्स। इन फर्स्ट लेक्चर यू वर इंट्रोड्यूस्ड विद द वेरियस सिस्टम फिनमना मटीरियल्स एंड मड्यूल्स एंड एप्लीकेशंस ऑफ रिवर्स ऑस्मोसिस। एंड देन इन द सेकेंड पार्ट वी डिस्कस अबाउट द डिज़ाइन ऑफ रिवर्स ऑस्मोसिस सिस्टम्स, इन विच वी एक्चुअली लुक एट वेरियस पैरामीटर्स विच आर कैलकुलेटेड व्हेन यू आर डिज़ाइनिंग रिवर्स ऑस्मोसिस सिस्टम। एंड एट द एंड ऑफ दैट लेक्चर वी हैव डिस्कस वन प्रॉब्लम इन डिटेल। सो यू आर एडवाइज टू सॉल्व अदर प्रॉब्लम फ्रॉम अनसॉल्व प्रॉब्लम रिलेटेड टू रिवर्स ऑस्मोसिस सिस्टम विच वी हैव डिस्कस्ड। सो इन दिस टॉपिक ऑफ गैस परमिएशन टुडे अगेन वी हैव टू मेन स्टडी वेरियस पॉइंट्स रिलेटेड टू दिस दैट विल इंक्लूड लाइक इंट्रोडक्शन एंड मैकेनिज्म ऑफ गैस परमिएशन मेम्ब्रेन एंड इफेक्ट ऑफ प्रेशर। सम हाउ फ्यू पॉइंट्स विल बी रिलेटेड टू द रिवर्स ऑस्मोसिस मेम्ब्रेन, बट फ्यू विल बी न्यू हेयर। एंड देन देयर इज एप्लीकेशन एंड मटीरियल्स प्लस मेड्यूल्स विच आर यूज फॉर गैस परमिएशन मेम्ब्रेन ऑन इंडस्ट्रियल स्केल मोस्ट ऑफ द टाइम। देर आर फ्यू प्रॉब्लम्स रिलेटेड टू मेम्ब्रेन्स एंड स्पेशली गैस परमिएशन मेम्ब्रेन, सो वी विल लुक एट दैम। एंड वन ऑफ दोज इज़ मेम्ब्रेन फाउलिंग। एंड एट द एंड ऑफ द लेक्चर वी हैव टू डिस्कस हाउ इंडस्ट्रियल स्केल मेम्ब्रेन सिस्टम्स फॉर गैस सेपरेशन ऑपरेट। एज वी हैव डिस्कस सम हाउ सिमिलर सिस्टम फॉर रिवर्स ऑस्मोसिस, वी लुक एट दैट इफ़ यू आर यूजिंग रिवर्स ऑस्मोसिस सिस्टम फॉर इंडस्ट्रियल एप्लीकेशन। सो दैट्स नॉट ओनली वन मेम्ब्रेन मॉड्यूल ऑफ RO, देर आर वेरियस अदर प्री ट्रीटमेंट यूनिट। सो सम हाउ सिमिलर सिस्टम्स वी हैव टू लुक फॉर गैस परमिएशन। एंड वन थिंग आई वॉन्ट टेल यू हियर, एक्चुअली वी विल नॉट कवर आर दैट्स ऑल्सो नॉट mean included in your course for this gas permeation like new. So for reverse osmosis numerical problems are included, but for gas permeation we are not going to talk about those problems. And mean then definitely unsolved problem will not be included for this section. Let's start with the basic gas separation technologies. When you look at various main gas separation on industrial scale, so there are few technologies which are called as conventional technologies. Actually, conventional technologies include all other separation mechanisms, separation techniques, except membrane. So that's the one commonly used technique. On large scale, even still, it is used for few plants. That's cryogenic distillation of air. Cryogenic, already hopefully you are aware about this word. That's something at very low temperature. So when we say that cryogenic distillation of air, it's mean air is already in the air is in gaseous phase. So you have to cool it down to very low temperature so that it is condensed. Actually, the constituents of air, that's nitrogen, oxygen, they are condensed, and then you go for distillation, for separation of those constituents. So this is one of the technique which is used for like separating either oxygen or nitrogen from air. Then there is condensation to remove condensable organic vapors from gas mixture. When various gas mixture, especially in natural gas industry, when you want to separate these smaller hydrocarbons from gas streams. So the one method which is used is to condense those condensables. Suppose if it is a mixture of various hydrocarbon which includes from methane and then higher hydrocarbon, so some of those can be separated from these gases by using condensation. And in that condensation, what you have to do, you have to increase the pressure or decrease the temperature, and most of the time this decrease in temperature is used, like you remove the heat and some part of the feed is condensed. So then you bring it to some separating unit, like in either distillation or some stripping unit, or maybe you just give them some time for settling and they are separated based on the gravity after this condensation. So this is the other technique, which is conventional technique. And then the most common used technique still on industrial scale, that's for amine absorption. That's amine absorption, and this is used to remove various acidic gases from natural gas, like carbon dioxide, there is moisture, there is hydrogen sulfide. So they are removed with the help of this absorption technique. And when we discussed the absorption, we have talked about this, like you have to bring some absorbent and then there is regeneration of absorbent. So it is common technique like absorption and stripping technique for removal of these acidic gases from natural gas. So all these techniques have some problems. Due to this, we have to look for membranes. So before looking for membrane, let's look at those problems. What are those problems with these techniques? Although these are conventional one and they are being used on large scale and for various application, but a few problems are like this. First of all, I mean, when you have to use one of these techniques, so this require gas to liquid phase change. For example, like if we were looking at even this cryogenic distillation, in which you have to condense, you have to reduce the temperature a lot so that you can condense the constituents of air, or some of those are at least separated or mean condensed, and then you can separate them with distillation. Then there is like this condensation, in which you have to remove the heat and you have to convert from gas to the liquid phase. They were in the vapor phase and then they are condensed. So all this required removal of heat. Then there is phase change that adds a significant energy cost to the separation unit. Like phase change here, this again same phase change, somehow they are interconnected points. So overall, these techniques you have to go, you have to go for phase change, and when you are going for phase change, definitely it involves cost, energy cost. You have to provide the coolants, and by the way, these are not so common or easy condensation or change in temperature, like maybe you will be thinking it's simple with the help of water. No, here you need refrigerants and very low cooling media, so that's expensive one. So then there are some environmental problem with the amine absorption system, although this didn't involve as such these cost of like cooling as such. There are some costs, but not like too much like these condensation or cryogenic, but this has problem of environmental, like these amines which are used for removal of these gases, some of those are released, they are just as they escape from the system with these gases when they are leaving, so definitely they are hazardous for environment. So these are few problem. Maybe you can also go through the literature and you can find various other problem which are associated with these technologies. So now, in order to overcome these problem or to avoid these problem, we have to look for some alternatives. So we have to actually avoid these techniques. We will use another technique that's called actually membrane gas separation. So when you look at membrane gas separation units, actually definitely when you are going to adopt a new technology, it should be better than the previous one. So it will counter the previous one, like this has many advantage as compared to the previous technique. First one, when you are going for gas separation, here no phase change is required. Just you have to bring, suppose there is a mixture of hydrocarbons, lighter and heavier, you bring it in contact with the membrane, some of those will pass through the membrane and other will just stay at the surface of membrane, and they will be collected as retentate, and those which pass through the membrane, they are collected as a permeate. Then like gas permeation membrane unit are most of the time smaller as compared to other plants. For example, if you compare them with the amine absorption and stripping units, so they are very large unit, as well distillation unit, they are large unit as compared to those on industrial scale. These are small unit, and when these are small, so they can be used even for offshore gas separating plants or gas separation application offshore, which are inside sea. Actually, you know that a lot of gas and these crude reservoir are located inside sea, and they are just explode there, they are produced, or they collect, or just take away that gas and crude. So if a gas plant is located inside that inside sea, so it's better to remove those gases, acidic gases, from the gas before transporting it to the onshore. Why? Because if those gases will be present in the gas and we didn't separate that, those are corrosive gases, they will CO2 and H2S, they will just react with the pipeline. If you are using the pipeline, or if you are using even some other container, so definitely there will be the problem. So due to this, and also transportation cost will be added, so there are various issues due to this. Those need to be separated, so the better option is to use membrane, because these are small scale plant as compared to other absorption and amine absorption stripping units, so you can use them even for offshore applications. Then there are some other advantages, like they are relatively low capital cost as compared to the other units. When you compare with them, relatively low cost, you can't say like membranes are quite cheap. No, relatively as compared to the other techniques, they are less costly, ease of installation, and then there is ease of operation. Their operation and installation is not difficult as compared to the other equipment. As well, there are not any like rotating equipment or parts inside the membrane. You have already discussed the modules of membrane, so there is no such issue of complex rotating equipment. Then high pressure high process flexibility. They can be used. You can easily change the membranes, and those module can be used for various application. And then there is low environmental impact. For example, if you just compare them, the largest application is of these membranes is for gas separation gas plants, because we are discussing this gas permeation. So majorly it is used on gas plants for separation of either hydrocarbon from the gases, liquid hydrocarbon from gases, or for removal of acidic gases from the natural gas or other gases. So for all those application, these will definitely create low environmental impact as compared to those amine systems. The one overall I should say disadvantage of the gas, when people criticize this gas separation through membrane, so they said you have to compress the gases, because when you are going for this gas separation through the membrane, you are already aware from RO, reverse osmosis system, that on the inlet side, feed side pressure should be high, and we will also talk about this later on in this lecture. So this problem can be overcome, or sometime it can be avoided, if your feed gas is already at high pressure, and you don't need to compress it. But definitely there will be compressor cost, but still, if you compare all this stuff based on cost with other technologies, as we have discussed in the last point, definitely membrane are still advantageous as compared to the other techniques or technologies. So up to here now, you know that okay, membranes can be used for gas separation and they are advantageous as compared to other technologies or techniques. So you will be thinking about it, that where we can use, or in which industries they are being used actually. So let's look at those. First of all, for example, if you look at ammonia plants, so they are unconverted, like hydrogen and nitrogen, if it is coming out of the reactor, so you have to just separate this hydrogen and nitrogen, and that's easy one with the help of membrane. So this membrane system are used for those separation for in ammonia plants, for hydrogen and nitrogen, unconverted hydrogen and nitrogen separation. Then there is separation of actually hydrogen from other hydrocarbon in petrochemical plants, where there are hydrocarbon and they contain the hydrogen. Maybe hydrogen is added for some reaction or maybe produced as a result of some reaction, so that can be separated from these hydrocarbon by using membrane. Maybe you will be thinking here hydrocarbon are already in the form of liquid, though not necessary. Sometimes they are hydrocarbon, lighter hydrocarbon, are in the form of gases. So if hydrogen is the part of those gases, that can be separated from those gases. And then next major application of these membranes is for separating nitrogen from air, in order to separate actually oxygen and nitrogen, which are major constituents of air. So you can use this technique, or membrane technology is used. As we talked in the start, that there is one technique, cryogenic distillation, but that needs very low temperature, and that's much costly as compared to membranes. Membrane are cheap one and good selection for this separation. Then there is CO2 and water removal from natural gas. All major natural gas plants in the world, they definitely natural gas which is extracted from the air, from the ground, that contains various impurities, and CO2, H2S and water, these are the three major impurities which are part of natural gas when it is extracted from the ground. So they need to be separated from this natural gas, and the best selection is membrane separation. Then there are organic vapor removal from air or nitrogen stream. Sometime in industries, if you have to remove like these organic chemicals, organic vapors from air stream, from nitrogen stream, so it's gas permeation membrane are used for those. By the way, one thing, maybe it will be surprising for you, that the world's largest gas separation membrane plant is installed in Pakistan. Like this was installed, I think, in 2004 in Kadarpur. It's located inside Sindh, so in interior Sindh, one of the plant, and based on one research paper which was published in 2006. At the end of the lecture, I have link for that paper. So its production capacity of this plant are on daily basis, it was cleaning like 14 million cubic meter gas per day. So this was the capacity, and I was just reading through the Wikipedia. I'm not sure about that. So that the current capacity of this plant is somehow 17 million cubic meter per day for this very large plant that is using membrane system for separation of these carbon dioxide from natural gas, and the membrane material is cellulose acetate. Later on, you will come to know that why he has mentioned specifically cellulose acetate, because this is one of the common material which is used for synthesizing these membrane gas separation membrane. So this plant and many other plants, maybe I was just searching for it, I can't find any other plant. So all information, world largest gas separation plant is located in the Pakistan, and that's separating very huge large amount of gas on daily basis. So these gas mixtures can be separated by membrane. When you look at these membrane, we are going to now start with the mechanism. We have discussed that where they are majorly used. So mechanism you can use either you have studied there are porous or dense membrane and non-porous or microporous membrane. Microporous is the same, and non-porous are dense membrane. They are used for gas separation, and both can be used, but more majorly actually non-porous membranes are the much better selection, and because through these membrane you know that separation takes place based on some properties of the membrane material or the interaction of membrane material with the components that you are separating, and through the membrane suction and diffusion of some component can take place, some are easy to separate while others are not. While if you will select porous membrane, definitely then you have to take care of the pore size of those membrane, and because gases, most of the gases, they have very small dia, so it will be difficult to separate them with the help of porous membrane. So most of the time non-porous membrane are used for this application. So when you look at these membranes which are used for gas permeation, and actually if you compare them with the reverse osmosis and pervaporation, or the if you look at the phenomena or the driving force which is needed for separation of these membranes, so most of the time these dense polymer membranes are used for this gas separation, and they follow Fick's law. And you know that in Fick's law we consider the driving force, and driving force is actually partial pressure difference of the gases across the membrane, so that's the driving force which help us to separate the gases. So similarly, like when we discuss reverse osmosis, we said that pressure difference across the membrane, so again here pressure difference across the membrane is the driving force. Let's look at this one of the membrane like we have seen for reverse osmosis. So here we consider a asymmetric or thin film, again composite membrane. And you remember, what does this mean? Asymmetric mean that will contain one top layer, that is the dense membrane, that is active layer, and then there are a porous membrane below this, and they are being used actually for supporting the top layer. So here some feed gas which is we just consider here that it's a mixture of hydrocarbons, and there are two type of hydrocarbon, low molecular weight hydrocarbon and high molecular weight hydrocarbon. And for this example we just consider that low molecular weight hydrocarbons are represented with A, and their molecular weight is actually less than 50. So while for heavier this will be definitely greater than 50, so they are represented with the B. So they are entering in this system, or their feed gas pressure is P1, and on the other side when this through this membrane some of the component will pass, like here you can see that for species A, all those which have like low molecular weight, they can fastly pass through this membrane because all these are hydrocarbon, this is hydrocarbon mixture. And out of those lecture back I think we also studied that small molecule have mostly good diffusion through the membrane, so definitely they will have fast permeation through membrane if they belong to the same family, because these are hydrocarbon. But if some other component will come here, then we can't apply like this rule that lighter will have always, like we can't generalize it that like always lighter have fast permeation. It is not necessary. In next slide we will also look at this. So then there are B type species, heavy molecular weight species, they have slow permeation. As I told you already, for these membrane application, membranes are not like 100% selective, they allow also other species to pass through, mean they can't 100% retain, or they can't stop molecules of B to pass through. Some of those will definitely pass through this membrane along with the components of A. So on the other side pressure is P2. And usually this pressure is very small, like as he mentioned, it is somehow equivalent to the ambient pressure. And why we are like keeping a greater difference here, on this side mostly pressure is high. We have some pressure condition in next few slides, so you can see that here on this side pressure is very high. It can vary from like 10 atmospheric to 150 atmospheric pressure. On the other side you are looking like it is only 1 atmospheric. So it's mean like there is a huge driving force. And you know in the last slide we also talked about this, that if there will be high pressure drop, then high pressure difference, so there will be high driving force for the passage of these components which are passing through the membrane. So here we are using asymmetric or thin wall composite membrane. And why we are using asymmetric, because in here there is high pressure on one side and very low pressure on the other side. So in order to sustain this pressure, actually you just support the dense membrane on the surface of other non-porous sorry, porous membrane, top surface active layer, dense membrane which is non-porous, and below that there will be membrane which are porous. The similar system as you have discussed about reverse osmosis membrane. Most of the time these similar kind of systems are used, because in that also pressure was high, again here pressure is even higher than that system. So you will need the support for membrane in order to avoid rupture or damage of the membrane. So through dense membrane, those species are absorbed actually, which some of absorbed, and they can easily pass through the membrane, which are allowed to pass through, like species A, while other they can't pass through this membrane, or very small amount of those species will pass through the membrane. So at the end of the day, when you look at the separation, definitely your permeate will be enriched in A, that will contain A in the large amount, while retentate will have B components in large amount. But near perfect separation is generally not achievable. Near perfect mean like only A on the permeate side and only B on the retentate side. That's not achievable. Most of the time some component of the B will be part of A and the permeate side, while some part of A will be still left on retentate side. So this was about majorly dense membrane, but if sometime, as we have seen, that even porous membrane can also be used for this membrane separation. So if membrane is microporous, then pore side you have to look at this very carefully, that pore size should be such that when you are synthesizing the membrane or selecting the membrane, it should have like such pore size that some components of your feed will only pass through this, and while other will be stopped based on their size. So here in this figure still you can see like you are passing actually compressed air through this membrane. So when it is just entering through this membrane module, and overall this will be like somehow something like this as it is shown here, like there will be fibers or there will be like capillaries through which this air passes. And some of those components are actually permeated, they can leave through the membrane. I think one example related to this we have already discussed somewhere in the previous lecture. So permeate will contain actually oxygen, CO2, there will be helium and this all other stuff, while the retentate is actually nitrogen which can't pass through this membrane. So here you can see based on this it is shown here, like for this membrane actually, when you look at this passage through this membrane, or actually permeability through this membrane, is fast on this end and on the other end it is slow. So based on this you can just look at various gases. Some of those gases, like if there is water, CO2, hydrogen, helium, they have relatively fast passage through this membrane, while when you keep on moving to the other end, like there is nitrogen and CH4, through this one specific example of the membrane they can't pass through. By the way, this is from one of the main research paper in which he has compared various gases passage through some specific membrane. So through this membrane actually nitrogen and CH4, they have very slow permeation. So due to this, the most of the nitrogen will be released as a retentate, and permeate will consist of other gases. So this was all about the mechanism of the membrane, how does this membrane separation or membrane permeation applies. That's quite similar to the reverse osmosis membrane. Just the difference here is, in reverse osmosis you mainly consider the liquid streams, but here in gas separation your streams are actually in the form of gases. And when you looked at reverse osmosis, the difference that like where when we were considering the liquid stream and we were separating some of the salts or solids from that liquid, and liquid water was passing through the membrane, while in the gas mixture actually some of the gases passes through the membrane and while other are retained. So these are some major differences from reverse osmosis. Let's look at various materials and modules as we have seen for reverse osmosis. Again here for these gas separation membranes, so number of polymers are actually suitable for gas permeation membrane, or when you look at gas permeation application. For example, earlier in gas permeation GP, for gas permeation application use non-porous membranes, majorly non-porous. As I told you in the previous slide, that most of the time non-porous membranes are used, because for porous it is difficult to take such membrane which has some specific pores which allow some gases to pass through and other are retained. It's difficult, as as compared to the some other application which are size based separation. For gases, mostly size based separation is very difficult. It is majorly done based on the diffusion through the membrane. So non-porous membrane of cellulose acetate and polysulfone were used for this application of gas separation, and they are still dominant, or I mean they are being used on many industrial application. And now from here you can recall that the Pakistani gas plant which he has mentioned, and he specifically mentioned that that's using cellulose acetate membrane, and that plant was installed in like 2004 and still using the same kind of the membranes. Some other, as he mentioned, number of polymers, so cellulose acetate and polysulfone are predominantly or most of the time used membrane due to various advantages compared to other, but some other membranes are also used for specific application, like we have seen that membranes can be used for many applications, so only one material is not good for all application. Definitely you have to look for some alternative like polyamide, polyamides, polycarbonate, like polyetheramides, sulfonated polysulfone, and then some other like polystyrene, silicon rubber membrane, they are used for some application, and like up to 70 degrees C, these components which are presented here, these polymers can also be used. So at least remember the name of one, two specific material which are used for gas separation applications. As I was telling you that non-porous membrane or dense membrane are the good selection when you look at gas separation. So its mean elimination of pores is critical or crucial for successful separation of membranes. So sometime in order to avoid these pores, so you use composite membrane. Now what does this mean? Composite mean it will consist of the two components. One component here is like polysulfone, and it is coated with, or that surface of that membrane is coated with another another material, that silicon. If you just take this polymer polysulfone, and if its surface is defective mean it contains some smaller pore, it is not totally dense, so that's mean like those pores can be avoided, or they are filled with silicon. You just coat the silicon its surface, and that will be stopped, or pores will be just closed. So these composite membrane can be used for those application. Then there is relative permeability of a number of gases through this silicon. Presented is one figure in which you can see that relative permeability of number of gases. When you select, suppose this silicon coated polysulfone membrane, and you are going for some separation, so if you have to use this membrane, and then you have to look either this membrane is suitable for that separation or not. So here just permeability is given on one, and this is low permeability of its mean like permeability of those components which are presented on this side will be low through this membrane, while on the other end some components are presented which will have high permeability through the membrane. So suppose your membrane consists of, like, you have to separate hydrogen and nitrogen. So now from here you can see that hydrogen and nitrogen, they can be separated through this membrane. While on the other end, if you look at this, suppose your nitrogen and CH4, they are part of some stream and you want to separate, so at least this silicon coated polysulfone membrane is not good selection. You have to look for some other material, and similarly you can look for the other. So same kind of data are available, because now membranes are being used from, like, as you have studied from 1980s. They are being used in the industry on large scale, so a lot of data is available for these kind of systems in which you can look at the membrane which are suitable for your system. From here, one thing you can also notice, like sometimes suppose just look at this water molecule, if you look with respect to like its molecular weight at this water, and then there is CH4. So if you compare based on molecular weight, you can see that they are quite close to each other, like this is 16 and water is 18, but through this specific component, and maybe I'm not sure about their diameter, but if you can find their diameter of water and CH4, so you can see that if you use maybe the porous membrane, it will be difficult to separate these because they will be quite close to each other. But here in non-porous membrane, through this membrane, they can be easily separated because they have different diffusivities through the membrane, different permeability through the membrane. No, these were all about membrane material, the selection of membrane material and various material which are used for membrane. Next is about modules, because we are discussing membrane material and modules. So modules are preferred which have high packing density. What does this mean? That for given volume, your surface area should be higher. And for this purpose, most of the time, hollow fiber membrane and spiral wound membrane, these are the best main selection, because they have high packing density. And for all large scale gas permeation plants, these are the two which are commonly used. So usually, very fine fibers are used, like for hollow fiber membrane. So membrane packing area is up to 50,000 meter square per cubic meter. So this is very huge packing area which is available for 1 cubic meter. Even you have 50,000 cubic meter of the membrane separation surface available in membrane separation surface. So spiral wound even are more dense as compared to these, so they can be used for this gas separation. And what will happen with this, actually you have more good separation in these kind of modules. Otherwise, if you are using other module, definitely you can go for separation. You can separate, but you will need more number of units for those module as compared to these two. So these module usually operate at very high pressure, as I told you. So here one mentioned that it can be as high as almost 15 megapascal, like 14.8, almost 15 megapascal, or it can be like this around 1 megapascal. So this is very high pressure on which these membrane can operate, and this 15 megapascal is around, I think, 2100 PSIA, are around 150 atmospheric pressure. So it's very huge pressure, and due to this gas separation takes place, and its flux will be high, because as high pressure you have on the feed side and as low on the permeate side, so difference will be high. It will give you more good flux, more high flux. And as well, in order to support this or support the membrane, then we go for combination of porous and non-porous membrane, or like asymmetric membranes. Here are few specific industrial application which are discussed actually in your textbook. So most rapidly developing application of gas permeation has been started in like 1986. From that time, now they have been used widely in various application. So available membrane have separation factor for oxygen with nitrogen with the factor of 3 to 7. Like if you have to separate oxygen from the nitrogen, so the membrane can be used, and they can give you like separation of up from 3 to 7 based on the conditions. Then there is product purities. For example, if you use membranes on commercial scale and you look at this, you can see actually here. By the way, what does this separation factor mean? Maybe it's mean like oxygen to the nitrogen ratio of the separation is 3 to 7. So based on this example, in next point you can see, like if you use it on industrial scale, this is economically limited to return rate of 95 to 99.9%. Some membranes are available which can allow oxygen to pass through and nitrogen is retained, and its purity is up to like somehow 95 to 99.9% even. In all oxygen somehow can pass through this membrane and nitrogen is only left. While on the other side, when you look at permeate side, actually there's 30% to the 45% oxygen, and definitely other will be nitrogen and other gases which also pass with the oxygen through the membrane. So if you look at membrane, these can be used for some very close boiling hydrocarbon, for separation of close boiling hydrocarbons. If these highly selective membrane are developed in the future, actually he mentions like these can be used even to separate ethylene and ethane. This is these will be close boiling hydrocarbons. One is actually saturated and other is unsaturated hydrocarbon, but both are C2. So due to their close boiling, it's very difficult to separate them with the help of like distillation. Otherwise you will need very tall distillation separation column for such kind of separation, but through membrane they can be easily separated. And a lot of research is going on. I mean, if you look at these membrane technologies, the research continues or current research, so you can find a lot of such application in which people are developing the membrane which can separate actually close boiling hydrocarbons. Then they can also be used for close boiling organic other mixture like propane, propene, these ethane, ethylene, methane, ethane, and many other applications you can see. So another application or industrial scale application of this first one which we discussed, that was oxygen and nitrogen separation. Now it's about nitrogen and hydrogen, and we have talked about this few slides back about ammonia. In ammonia plant they can be separated. So gas permeation also competes favorably for hydrogen recovery from nitrogen and hydrogen stream. Because of high separation factor, some of the material give good separation of these membranes, these components through the membrane. So rate of permeation of hydrogen through the dense polymer membranes is more than 30 times than as compared to nitrogen. So in this case you can see that when hydrogen can pass through some membrane 30 times higher as compared to nitrogen, so definitely they can be easily separated. And through such membrane it is found that you can recover 95% of hydrogen through the feed gas. Suppose there was hydrogen and out specific amount of hydrogen, you can just take any value of hydrogen, and out of that 95% is recovered, or like that is permeated through the membrane, that is obtained as a permeate, and that's up to 90% purity. That's a huge purity. Only 10% will be like nitrogen with this, and through passing through other module you can easily separate that. While on feed side, there was initially, if it was initially 60% hydrogen, suppose you can consider like there will be 60 moles of hydrogen and 40 moles of nitrogen. So out of these 60, actually 95% of these, so that will be 0.95 of this 60 is passed on the permeate side. Only 5% will be left on feed side, that will be part of this retentate. And because nitrogen permeability is very small, so that will be left on retentate side. So these membranes, although polymeric membranes are widely used for many applications, but as we discussed also when we started with the membrane, that for high temperature application above 200 degrees C, most of the time polymeric membranes are not recommended or not good due to some problem with those glass transition temperature and some other issues. So then you go for inorganic membrane which are consist of either glass membrane, carbon membrane, or some inorganic oxide membrane which are available can operate at high temperature, but they have one problem, that they are limited in their selectivity as compared to like polymeric membrane, they are not good selective. When you look at this membrane, the other problem which you can face, that when feed contain condensable, suppose there are some hydrocarbon, like as we have seen in last example, lighter hydrocarbon and heavier hydrocarbon. So heavier hydrocarbon can easily condense as compared to lighter. So when those heavier hydrocarbons are part of some gas stream, so it is necessary to actually preheat the feed gas. Why? Because these heavier hydrocarbon, when lighter will pass through the membrane, only heavier will be left on this side, and due to reduction in that then partial pressures, they can get condensed. So it is preheated to prevent condensation on the retentate side when it become richer in actually only heavier or high molecular weight species. Then there is another problem of membrane which is actually called membrane fouling, which I told you in the start that membrane fouling is one of the major problem. And what is membrane fouling? Actually, as its name indicates, is fouling of surface, contamination of the surface with something, and that something is either solution or some particle. Maybe some of solution can get deposited on the surface of membrane that will form. Actually, that solution is not like simple like water. It will form a layer on the surface, thick layer on the surface of the membrane, and then there are sometimes the particle are accumulated on the surface. For example, even if you are separating the hydrocarbon, so heavier hydrocarbon can accumulate on the surface of the membrane. So while these sometime particle can be there in the gas stream, so they can also be accumulated on the surface of membrane, and they will create an extra resistance for the passage of other components through the gas. So in order to avoid these two problem like condensation problem and this membrane fouling and some other problems, actually membrane system are designed in such a way that you can minimize, although you can't totally eliminate, but at least you can reduce these problems. For example, here one of the membrane system is shown for the gas application, in which you can see that there is one membrane module here, hollow fiber membrane module here. But if you can see here, before bringing the gas to the membrane module, you are passing through some preliminary treatments. As we have seen in the case of reverse osmosis, you have to pass them through various pre-treatment units. So again, here we are also passing it through pre-treatment unit. So for example, air is coming in, this passes through coalescing, these filtration, then there is a heater, these are used for small particles which are part of this, they get separated through this filter, then you heat it up. Why you are heating? In order to avoid the condensation of some hydrocarbon. Then there is carbon filter that's used for adsorption of some of the components which are like impurities. It is not necessary to have all these units. It depends actually on the application, but some of those can be used for it. Just consider this is the heating system. Then there is filter, and filter can be more than one, or even they can be absent if there are not such kind of particles or such impurities which should be removed before bringing it to the membrane. Then there is particulate filter, and this is used to avoid actually this membrane fouling phenomenon which we have seen. And then it will pass through the membrane, and actually the major separation takes place through this membrane. All other we have removed already, and then you are collected, or you just collect your permeate and reagent it. That's the membrane system. That's it. In this lecture, actually we started with simple introduction to gas permeation process, when and why we go for gas separation through the membrane. Initially we talked about various technologies which are used on industrial scale for various gas separation, but they all suffer from some of a disadvantage. Due to this, it was necessary to go for membrane separation system. And then we have looked at which kind of the membrane material are used, which modules are better for membrane, what is the importance of pressure, what type of membrane, like either porous or non-porous membrane, should be used. Then at the end of the lecture, we have seen some of the problems which membranes usually encounter or come across. So in order to avoid those problem in gas separation membrane, you go for some preliminary treatment or pre-treatment before bringing your gas to the main gas separation unit. These are two links actually provided here, because a lot of this lecture is some major part of this lecture is actually from these two links. So if someone is interested, you can explore more through these links. So some is also included from your textbook. I will advise you to just at least go through the textbook when you are going through this topic. And thank you so much.